Oh, yeah. and by all his lotus feet with great honor and reverence. May these grace and through across the ocean material suffering and obtain the mercy of Krishna. My only wish is to have my consciousness purified with the words emanating from his lotus mouth. And passion to his lotus feet is reflection of those all desires. He opens the back of the eyes and fills my heart with transcendental lotus mouth.
Thank you. Bhakti Vaishnava Nimiki,
Acharya
Srila Haridas Thakur,
Jai.
Pepsico, Shri Krishna Devanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Vaita, Gadadhar, Shivasari, Gopi, Bhakti Nimiki,
Jai.
Shri Shri Radha Krishna, Gopi, Guna, Shyam, Kundra, Kundi, Guru, Guru, Dham,
Ki, Jai.
Vrindavan Dham, Ki,
Jai.
Vrindavan Dham, Ki, Jai. Vrindavan Dham, Ki,
Jai.
Jumana Mai, Ki,
Jai.
Yeah.
Vamshas. Okay. Brahma Vamshas Chajangire.
Brahma Vamshas Chajangire.
Shri Badarayana Vacha.
Shri Badarayana Vacha.
Puro Vamshas Pravakshami.
Puro Vamshas Pravakshami.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Rajasayo Vamsha.
Yatra Rajasayo Vamsha.
Brahma Vamshas Chajangire.
Brahma Vamshas Chajangire.
Shri Badarayana Vacha.
Shri Badarayana Vacha.
Purur Vamsham Prabhakshami.
Purur Vamsham Prabhakshami.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Raja Shayo Vyamsha.
Yatra Raja Shayo Vamsha.
Brahma Vamshas Chajagire.
Brahma Vamshas Chajagire.
Shri Badarayam Yirvacha.
Shri Badarayam Shami.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Jato Sibharata.
Yatra Raja Shayo Vamsha.
Yatra Raja Shayo Vamsha.
Brahma Vamshas Chajagire.
Brahma Vamshas Chajagire.
Sukadeva Goswami said,
O Maharaj Prakshit,
descendant of Maharaj Bharata.
Descendant of Maharaj Bharata.
I shall now describe the dynasty of Prabhu.
I shall now describe the dynasty of Prabhu.
In which you were born.
In which you were born.
In which many saintly kings appeared.
In which many saintly kings appeared.
And from which many dynasties of Brahmanas began.
And from which many dynasties of Brahmanas began.
For by His divine grace, Srila Prabhupada. There are many historic instances by which we can understand that from Kshatriyas many Brahmanas have been born, and that from Brahmanas many Kshatriyas have been born. The Lord Himself says in Bhagavad Gita 4.13, Chaturvarnyam Mayashristam Guna Karma Vibhagasya. According to the three modes of material nature and the work ascribed to them, the four divisions of human society were created by me. Therefore, regardless of the family in which one takes birth, when one is qualified with the symptoms of a particular section, he is also to be described accordingly. Yasya lakshanam proktam. Yal lakshanam proktam. One place in the Varna divisions of society is, I'm in denial about needing glasses for reading. One's place in the Varna divisions of society is determined according to one's symptoms or qualities. This is maintained everywhere in the Shastra. Birth is a secondary consideration. The first consideration is one's qualities and activities. Om Gyana Tamaranda Syaga Anjana Shalakaya Chakshurumabhyamrina Dasnayi Shri Chaitanya Maromi Sam Stavitami Nubutale Svayam Rupa Karamayam Dadati Svavaranam Vande Ham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Parakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavam Cha Shri Rupam Sargatatam Sargana Raghunatam Vitantam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Varijana Sagitam Krishna Tetam Yadevam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sargana Vavita Shri Sakhanikam Cha Hey Krishna Guruna Sindhu Dina Bandho Jagatpate Govesha Govita Namaste, Saraswati Devi, Lord of Ami, Prachane, Yavishesha, Srinivari, Jaya Sri Krishna, Chaitanya, Prabhu, Nityananda, Sri Advaita, Jagadamba, Srinivasa, Guru, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna, so this is actually a topic that Srila Prabhupada speaks a lot about through his teaching, especially when he's in India. He emphasizes this point that one is qualified by by one's guna and karma, one's qualities and one's activities, regardless of one's birth. Of course, there's the famous story of one person who came to a famous rishi. Who was the rishi? He wanted to be trained by this rishi to become a brahmana. And he asked to be a student. And so the great rishi said, "Well, what is your family? Who's your father?" And so he said, "Well, I don't know. I've never met my father."
So he said, well, go ask your mother. And so he went and asked his mother, and his mother said, well, I'm sorry, my dear son, but I have many partners, and I don't know who your father is. So so according to Vedic situation, such a birth is not even sudra, it's somewhere below. It's a very low birth. But when he went back to this rishi, and he said, I'm sorry, my mother doesn't know who my father is. I don't know what my lineage is. And the rishi said, oh, you're a Brahmana. Because he didn't hesitate to speak about this. He was, in other words, the quality of truthfulness was there, which is one of the principal qualities of the Brahminical character, is to be truthful. So he immediately recognized that you're in fact a Brahmana. You're someone that's qualified to understand Vedic literature. So that's an example. This verse also is a powerful example that Kshatriyas can take birth from Brahmana families. Brahmanas can take birth in Kshatriya families. And vice versa. I was thinking probably the biggest example of the opposite is the Hiranyakasipu and Hiranyaksha, who also took birth in Brahmana families. They're great Brahmanas, right? Actually, they're some of the greatest demoniac personalities of all time. They still are famous in history for their great demonic qualities, but they were born of Kashyapa Muni, right? great sage. So, and this, of course, yeah, Krishna says, Chaturvarnam, that once qualities within the Varnashram system, whether it's Shudra, Vaishya, Kshatriya, Brahmana, or whatever, are determined, these qualities exist. That's one thing he says, is that you will always find these qualities in human society, that these, they're necessary ingredients, these roles of different varnas and ashrams in society are necessary. There's always, despite endeavors to make a classless society, there's always different classes of people. And that's because it's a natural way, it's given by Krishna. And if understanding that, if everyone, according to their nature, is elevated to saintly character within their varna and ashram, then society can flourish. It's not that someone needs to imitate. In fact, Krishna Bhagavad Gita says that we shouldn't imitate another one's duty. So this is dangerous, a source of fall down. Whether we should recognize our character, our nature, and work according to that nature, that we can make progress. Most importantly, we can serve Krishna according to our nature. And also in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that regardless of our birth, we can serve him. Krishna's an equal opportunity employer. Regardless of one's situation, we become qualified, we develop saintly qualities even. There are so many examples of saintly. Of course, in Lord Chaitanya's time, there was Kulavit Sridhar, who was simply selling clay or banana leaf cups. Very simple person, apparently, but he is the greatest Vaishnava because of his love for Krishna. So regardless of one's position, we can develop the requisite qualities of becoming a Vaishnava, becoming a devotee. So it's not according. So, the other point I was making is that we're all stuck with a particular nature. Like it or not. Sometimes we like it, sometimes we don't. But regardless of what that is, we can elevate ourselves by service to Krishna. That's open for everyone. But we're always, again, it's mentioned that we can be recognized or understood by our guna and karma, our qualities, not by the birth. It's wonderful, this dynasty of kings, how so many kings appeared in this dynasty. We hear about the saintly character of these personalities. They're called, it's amazing. He says here, Yatra Raja Chayo. In this dynasty, you have appeared, Omar's Prakshit, who was a great, who is Rajarshi, means a king, Raja, but Rishi, who's a saintly person, who's wise, who's full of knowledge. So it's wonderful that you've appeared in this dynasty, and there are many other great Rajarshis and Ramanas who have appeared. But it's by the culture, it's by the training, it's by the character of these dynasties and what they bring and how they educate their followers and the principles that they hold, that they're recognized not by So I always thought this verse, Yashayalakshanam Portam, it's mentioned here, Pum Sovarna Vivyan Shakam, such an important verse in Vedic literature, that this Lakshanam, these qualities, this verse was spoken by Narada Muni to Maharaj Yudhisthira, I believe, yeah. He was questioning, Yudhisthira was questioning, what are the duties of human society? How should we act? How should we behave? And he specifically asked about the different qualities of the different varnas. So he began this description by listing 32 qualities that are necessary for any human being. And I don't remember them right at this moment, but they're qualities such as honesty, austerity, truthfulness, mercy, cleanliness, like this. These, regardless of one's situation, these qualities, we should see that these qualities are developing in us. Again, it's not by birth that these qualities come about, although there may be advantages by birth, but still these things have to develop by practice, by training, by one's personal desire and endeavor to develop such qualities. So then he describes all the different varnas and ashramas, and it's interesting that the Vedic culture was so high that even the Shudras, who are considered the workers, are generally not so educated, but in that section, they're also highly qualified people. I mean, more than myself, I can say that. The Shudras of that time were highly qualified in good behavior, and you could say saintly qualities. So then he concludes this whole section with this verse, Yashaya Lakshanam Protam, that all these qualities that I've mentioned of the different varnas and ashramas, Protam Pun Savana Vivyanchakam, that one can be understood and by their qualities, whether they're a brahmana, a priest, or a teacher like this, or a kshatriya, martial class, or administrator, vaishya, to protector of the cows, or someone who deals in trade, and so on and so forth, or shudras, or those who assist the other classes, those who are workers. So these people are all needed in society. So one can understand what one is by one's qualities. Pumsha Varna, the Varna is understood by Vivyanchakam, the Lakshana. And Yadan Yatrapi just Chaitanya. If these qualities are seen elsewhere, in other words, specifically says, even if one isn't born in such and such family, if they're seen to have these qualities, then they should be understood in that way, that this is what they are. So this is so significant. We know from history, well, according to Bhagavatam, that Srila Prabhupada often he criticizes the caste system in India, as it rightly should be criticized. It's the source of so many problems and injustices. And this began approximately 5,000 years ago when Preachy was cursed by Sringi. Isn't that generally understood that way? And you know the history, we can tell it a little bit, but Maharaj Preachy was a great saintly king, but on one occasion he was very, very tired and exhausted and thirsty and from his martial endeavors. And in this situation, he came into a hermitage. And so he just wanted some water. And he was asking, you know, the saintly people there, give me some water. But they were all completely immersed in meditation, and they didn't respond to him, especially the one leader of the ashram was just absorbed in meditation and didn't respond to him. So overcome with hunger and thirst, he became very angry and he hung a dead snake around his neck to just as a kind of an insult, which was, of course, completely against the king's character normally. But of course this was prompted by Krishna so that we could hear Srimad Bhagavatam as Preachy was doing. So so then he went away, and then the Brahmana came to external consciousness, and he wasn't offended because he was a qualified Brahmana, actually. The qualification of a saintly person is that they don't take offense. But his son became very infuriated. Sringi, was qualified with some of the Brahma Tejas. He was powerful enough to curse people. But he wasn't actually qualified with the Brahminical quality of tolerance and mercy and so on and so forth, which are the actual characteristics. So anyway, he cursed Maharaj Preachy, and when his father came to understand this, he said, you just destroyed the world. Because the whole world is dependent on this saintly king, who's such a wonderful person, such an important person, and for a slight offense, you've cursed him. So this excessive pride, that in other words, thinking that because I'm a quote-unquote brahmana, a priest, that I'm better than others, and others should respect me, and others should look up to me, and belittling the lower, quote-unquote, lower classes. This is the downfall of the Brahminical society historically. And of course, it continues to this day. Of course, not everyone. There are many saintly persons still in Brahminical families. But as a general tendency, this was there. So the Brahmanas began to misuse their position as the natural leaders or counselors of society for their own material gain. And to become a Brahmana, you had to take birth in a Brahmana family, otherwise you couldn't become a Brahmana. Even this was the large Srila Prabhupada's preaching in India, a large part of what he had to deal with from many people was that he was making malechas and yavanas, ourselves, our good selves, in other words, people not born in Brahmanical families, he was initiating them as Brahmanas and training them in that way, and this was considered to be destroying the Brahmanical culture. So he had very much to fight against this idea, and he spoke a lot about it. Again, this idea that it's not by birth, but it's by qualities, and that one can be trained, one can develop saintly qualities. Sanatana Goswami also, can't think of the verse, but anyway, he says that just as bell metal or base metal can be transformed into gold by an alchemical process. If anybody knows this process, you can meet me after class. But anyway, apparently there is such a process. Does anybody know? So anyway, the idea is to take a crude metal, and it can be turned into gold by this mystical alchemical process. Or sometimes it's said a touchstone. And so in the same way that by diksha, tataha diksha vidanina dvijitam jayatena, an ordinary person said that, especially in Kali Yuga, Kalo Sudra Samava, that no one's born qualified, especially now, but we're naturally born with lower qualities. But by association, by taking instruction and shelter of a saintly person, this is called diksha, then an ordinary person can become twice born, second born. And of course, the primary meaning of the word Brahmana is one who understands Brahma, who understands spirit. Ultimately, the highest knowledge of spirit is to understand Krishna, to be a devotee of Krishna. So, these are things that Srila Prabhupada explained to us again. And even beyond the qualifications of a Brahmana, Lord Chaitanya stressed that one could even become a guru, a teacher of others, not by one's birth. What's the verse? Kiva vipra, kiva nasi, sudra kinyanai, ye krishna tattva veta se guru hoy. And the same thing he says, kiva vipra, whether one's a learned brahmana, or kiva vipra, kiva nasi, whether one's a sannyasi, shudra, if one is born in the lower class, kinyanai, whatever it may be, ye krishna tattva veta, if such a person actually understands Krishna, then they should be accepted as a guru. So that was the qualification. And Krishna himself says, mami parta vipashrutya ye pishu papayami, that regardless of one's birth, if they take shelter of me, if someone takes shelter of me, te piyanti parangitam, they can achieve the supreme destination. So, essentially we can say our only qualification is that we take shelter of Krishna. We can take shelter of saintly persons. And we know saintly persons are like touchstones, that it's said that, you know, our goal is to become attracted to Krishna. In material life, we're attracted to so many other things, but the attraction isn't in the object. The attraction lies in the heart of one who's attracted. So if we can take shelter of, have the association of saintly persons and read and study Srimad Bhagavatam, then that same attraction, that same love for Krishna that is within their heart can awaken in our heart. And then by that love for Krishna, we can gradually understand Krishna. So I was thinking just one more point on this, is that this historical understanding of how the Brahmins you know, the whole, well, actually, with the downfall of the Brahmana society, then gradually, of course, none of the Kshatriyas respected the Brahmanas, actually. So that means the ruling class no longer had good advisors. They no longer had advisors that they could trust. So they became uncontrolled. And then, you know, we came in our modern history, we have the French Revolution and this revolution, and we just have a whole history of corrupt kings. Actually, from the it's interesting, we're hearing now about the saintly kings, and there's just one after another, all these amazing personalities. And then we come to the 12th canto, and it starts describing the dynasties. And it's a typical situation that we have today. That because again they no longer took counsel from saintly persons. They thought they were completely autonomous to rule how they wanted, and they simply wanted the kingdom for their own aggrandizement, their own benefit. And so you have these histories, you know, this person killed his brother to get the kingdom, and so on and so forth. Typical scenario we have of modern dynasties. You know, this, you know, yeah, one person being killed. I remember I was in, we were in Bulgaria, and there was this kingdom there, and there was this castle, this old castle. And then on the castle wall, there's a list of the ruling kings. Right? And it's a long list. You know, there's like 20, 30 ruling kings. So we were looking at this list, and we come to understand that that list extended over about 100 years. It means one king, you know, I'm the king, you know, this is my kingdom. You know, maybe 1 or 2 years later, he was taken out by another family member or something, you know, poisoned or killed in his sleep or something, and then a new person, I'm the king, you know. So this is kind of so people in modern times, of course, they're disgusted with any kind of leadership practically, because it's basically corrupt. They're people that have their own agenda, their own idea. They're not actually don't actually have people's interests at heart. They have simply their own interests at heart. What was it, one queen said, let them eat cake,
Queen Teresa.
It's attributed to Marie Antoinette.
In France, yeah. Yes.
But actually she never said it.
She never said it. We have the historian here.
It was propaganda.
Oh, it was propaganda to get rid of it.
And we've been repeating it ever since.
Oh, okay. Gosh, even then there was false news. Even before Facebook. Okay. Anyway, it's complex. It's complicated. But I was thinking that for our own selves, we should also take this seriously, that we've in a sense taken initiation into a great family. When someone takes initiation, then they're considered to become part of the Achyuta Gotra, right? The family of Krishna, the family of Krishna's family, Krishna's dynasty. So, but again, we shouldn't think that, oh, I'm a Prabhupada disciple, or I'm a so-and-so disciple, and business finished. And we should be very cautious on this point that that's the beginning, that's our good fortune to have the association and to be reborn, dvija, that they our second spiritual birth in this family of Srila Prabhupada and Krishna's family, and to have this opportunity. But we need to diligently develop qualities, requisite qualities that we can properly represent Srila Prabhupada, and that we can present his teachings as he presented them, and we can properly represent him, and be actually his followers, his true followers. It was pointed out by, I think, Rita Nandamaras that Srila Prabhupada his family didn't really follow him. Even really didn't follow him. I think there was an instance, one of his sons went sued ISKCON, is that okay, something like that. So he made the point that perhaps this was Krishna's arrangement so that we wouldn't be confused with this idea that somehow or other we're qualified by birth, I'm Prabhupada's son or something like that. But similarly, we shouldn't think I'm Prabhupada's disciple without taking seriously his teachings. We say in the morning, Arna Kriya Manyas, Sri Guru Mukha Padma Bhakya Chitate Karyakya. We should try to make his teachings one with our hearts and follow them. And this way we can become actual followers of Srila Prabhupada and develop these qualities. Yeah, it's a wonderful thing that by chanting Hare Krishna, we practically see this, that people become transformed. It actually happens by chanting Hare Krishna, by living with devotees, by serving Krishna. Gradually, over time, at least, people become transformed and become saintly persons. This is practically demonstrated. Hare Krishna. So, thank you for staying awake. Any questions, comments, refutations? Any Rudra Prabhu?
We see, even in the Bhagavatam, there are examples of devotees who exhibit the qualities of a devotee, and primarily brahminical qualities, but then at some point they fall down. And then they rectify themselves. In ISKCON we've seen devotees, big and small, who've gone through that experience. We've experienced it collectively, as, the results of it collectively, as well as individually. So what does that mean? That we see the lakshana of a saintly person, the qualities of a saintly person, certainly externally anyway, and internally, because we see the dedication to the Prabhupada, the service that's been rendered, the sacrifice that's been made. Yet then we see also sometimes, despite the development of all of these good qualities, this or the exhibition of all of these wonderful symptoms of devotion, we also then see sometimes the emergence of a less qualified
side.
But then again, we'll see again the revival of that emotional spirit in the character of a devotee. So what does that mean in terms of the quality or the nature of the person? It seems that it's not always fixed.
Correct.
And here's another thought. Just to stir it up a little bit more. We see sometimes in those cultures or ethnic settings, if you like, especially if we look at the dichotomy of, say, taking birth in India, a Bharat Vashi, and somebody who might be born in South Australia, for example.
Is that a high birth?
I can assure you it's not. So we see in some settings...
It's in the lower hemisphere.
In some settings, birth does have...
It has an impact. Yeah.
Even Prabhupada says, there's an interesting quote in the Bhagavatam. Prabhupada says, anybody who's born in India is naturally Krishna conscious, right? And Prabhupada says, even the Muslims.
Wow.
Even the Muslims, right? So it's interesting, isn't it, that on the one hand we're told it doesn't really matter, it's the lakshana and not the birth, but at the same time we also see that there is some connection. So we see the changes, especially we see in devotees this great dedication to their spiritual master and to service, and then over a period of time we see out comes the old personality, whatever it was, but then it again goes away. So what does that mean, do you think?
Excellent question.
The
second part, we could speak to that first, is that there's an endowment, just like my brother-in-law, right? My sister comes from a whole family of doctors. You know, the uncle's the doctor, the father's the doctor, the great-grandfather's the doctor, and they're all doctors. So undoubtedly he had an advantage to becoming a doctor by being born in that family. But still, he had to develop the qualifications. So, same idea. And of course, we know that we are put in certain families to learn certain lessons and due to our karma. So there is definitely that's a factor. Therefore, these are mentioned, the saintly dynasties, because they had that advantage of having a saintly birth, so it's definitely an advantage. Certainly, yeah, it's definitely an advantage. But nevertheless, we see people that don't take advantage of their heritage. Jagai and Madai are the classic examples of fallen Brahmanas, and you know there are others. And just the opposite, that we see people. It's amazing. You see people that you think they've got everything going against them, you know, and still they become saintly people. So we see instances of that. So although undoubtedly there's advantages to having, you know, a good parent, it certainly Srila Prabhupada encouraged us all to become good parents, to give our children all opportunities of the saintly association and transcendental knowledge from an early age. But as any parent knows, free will is supreme, especially when they hit their teens. so there's always that free will. And Srila Prabhupada explains that too, that Krishna never interferes with our free will, because the meaning of love is that it's given freely. If we're somehow or other forced in any way, shape, or form to love God, so-called love God, then that can't be love. If you hold a gun at someone's head and say, love me, they may temporarily act that way, but obviously they don't love you. So, yeah, so we're always, Krishna always gives us our free will. And, you know, that's always there. At the end of the Bhagavad Gita, we're reminded that, you know, he spoke everything to Arjuna, his dearmost devotee. He said, I've given you everything, I've given all knowledge. consider on it and do what you wish to do. So that's Krishna's nature, is that he doesn't interfere with our free will. And at the same time, he says that when people who do fall down, their qualification is that they pick themselves up, right? And what's the verse in English? That one may, he said, they're still to be considered if someone is worshiping me, even if they exhibit this, as you mentioned, this horrible behavior, but they never stop, they never give up worshiping me, then he says that's their qualification. The real qualification is to not give up, but let me keep trying to serve Krishna. So my understanding is, I just heard Srila, there's this amazing section about during Srila Shabdev's teaching, after his teachings, it describes how he became an avaduta and all that. I was just hearing Srila Prabhupada give a lecture on this, and there's this amazing verse how one should not put faith in the mind. You know, no intelligent person should put faith in their mind. It's just like one may think that they've trained a tiger, but if you just turn your back on the tiger, it'll devour you. So, and no sane person should trust their mind, because, and Prabhupada, at any moment the mind can become attracted in some unsavory way and carry us away. So as long as, until we keche kevalaya bhaktya vasudeva parayana, until we're actually awakened, until we're purified, our hearts are completely purified, until our love is awakened, then, Sukadeva Goswami says, at that point there's no possibility of falling down. Just like when the sun rises, it dissipates all the mist. So when unalloyed devotion is awoken within the heart, then at that time there's no possibility of falling down. Until that point, in that same lecture, Srila Prabhupada was saying, don't think, don't think now I've become very advanced, I know so much, so I don't have to really be careful about my mind. He said, no sir, it is not so easy. No, sir. It is not such an easy thing. So, there's always that chance of fall down that these things can come out. But in a higher sense, it's part of the journey, you can say. It would be nice. It would be if we can keep saintly association. Avoid offenses. I my own conviction is that a lot of these things come about due to offenses. That we have natural faults, we have natural weaknesses, but if somehow or other we offend devotees, or if we become offenses to others, then offensive to other people, then that really opens the gateway to get it to the material desires becoming overwhelming. That's, I believe, a strong thing that happens. And but in any so we should be cautious about that, and hopefully we can get pure. Well, my friend used to say, it's better to learn the hard way than not to learn. So sometimes we may have to learn a hard lesson by slipping from the path. And it's a lesson, it's a lesson, and it's humbling. I'm not a saint yet. So it's a hard lesson, but if we keep on the path, there's no loss. There's no loss or diminution. Krishna promises, and it says, same verse, chief pramabhati dharma, they'll quickly become saintly. So, yeah, but there's always possibility.
Yeah. Vishwa Chakravarti Thakur.
Vishwanath Thakur.
Vishwanath, yeah. In the Madhurya Kadambini, he mentions anattas or obstacles that arise as a result of
as a result the process of bhakti. Yeah. Okay.
And so we shouldn't be, we should be aware, I guess.
Yeah.
And vigilant.
Yeah.
Keep an eye out for those things that arise because you become successful in bhakti.
That's true.
And you'll bestow, and even Prabhupada mentions, but follow the process of bhakti and you'll be materially and spiritually successful.
Right.
But then we have to be very careful because with the material success comes the potential for distraction.
Yeah.
And enjoying the results.
To become proud and to think I'm an enjoyer of this situation.
Yeah, well, so many things. Got money.
Yeah.
Got followers.
Followers.
They tell you what a good person you are.
Yeah.
Then you discover you're not. And you feel, what's going on here?
Yeah.
Does this process work?
That's true.
Sometimes what happens?
That's funny.
Face big dilemmas and then they wonder, oh, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
I was in Allahabad and I met one yogi there. He told me he's traveling here and there. I asked him, how do you sponsor traveling? He said he's taking rings from poker and he's swallowing mercury.
Oh.
It's a problem.
Fire in the
okay,
night.
Okay, here we go.
Okay, and if there's water on the ring, it becomes gold. It sells the gold.
Yeah.
Just a little bit, just two sponsors traveling. So. Because you said something.
Okay.
Here's what Prabhupada says.
This is a real purport of our class.
here's what Prabhupada says. Tin, copper, and mercury. Proportionally mixed, it will become gold. Now you can do that experiment, then our poverty will be finished. It is a fact. There are many yogis, they prepare gold by drinking mercury. They drink mercury overnight. Next morning, they pass urine and dip copper coins in it. And then after some time, the copper coins put into the fire, it becomes gold.
Okay. Don't try this at home.
Mercury is poison.
Mercury is poison. So if you're powerful enough to drink mercury, and the brain can do that. Okay. On this light note, thank you so much for your saintly association. Shri Prabhupada ki
jai.
Shri Bhagavatam ki
jai.
Badahari Prabhu ki
jai.
Thank you.
Thank you. Where are you now? Where are you listening?
I've been twice before I went for Ramana's Ramana's medicine.
This is so different. I was saying, did you go to that walking place?
Yeah, I went to the walking
place. It reminded me so much of all age in Karnataka state.
Oh, really?
Beyond Udupi, there's a place called Kalmiga, and there is a river running through there. And I just felt like, it's like the river. I don't even know how that is like replicated here. The forest looked exactly the same. Sachinanda Maharaj took me back to Vrindavan. It just felt like being in Vrindavan with him here.
For the year here, so
I came for
that. This retreat is awesome. So happy to see you. I think the last time I saw you was a few years ago in Vrindavan.
Last year.
Staying here, what's the difference?
I think that's what's on the stuff.